So hearty good evening to one and all who are going to be watching this. We have with us in the research cell, Dayanand Sagar University, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Sivaguru Sritharan from MS Ramaiah University of Applied Sciences, who has kindly agreed to spare a few moments from his busy schedule and provide some opportunities on very specific aspect pertaining to the multidisciplinary and research focus in the new education policy 2020. I heartily welcome you, sir. Good evening.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. To give the viewers a brief perspective of your very illustrious and very lengthy career, I will highlight a few things, although the highlights might exceed a few points. Dr. Sivaguru S. Sritharan has been an accomplished leader and scholar in academia and in the US government. Internationally known mathematician and aerodynamicist. Consistently funded for nearly four decades by the Department of Defense and other US funding agencies for research. Pioneering scholar in developing control theory and stochastic methods for fluid dynamics and magnetohydrodynamics. Given over 350 seminars and lecture series in academic and research institutions around the world. He has served on advisory boards and panels in USA and across the world. He has advised PhD students and a number of MS students in several studies as well as postdoctoral fellows. He has served as branch head in Navy, department head, dean and provost and vice chancellor in the academia. Currently, he is the vice chancellor of MS Ramaiah University of Applied Sciences, Bengaluru. He has been before this in Air Force Institute of Technology as the provost and vice chancellor. The other positions that he has held are in the Naval Postgraduate School as the dean, professor, and director. Then he was also the dean of engineering and applied sciences from 2008 to 2011 as a professor of mathematics. Some other positions that he has held are as director, Center for Decision, Risk Controls and Signals Intelligence, professor of mathematics and undersea warfare, USW. In University of Wyoming, professor of mathematics and department head, and power scientist branch head. The other positions he has been into is University of Colorado as the visiting professor and research professor, and in University of Southern California, among others. Education-wise, he has a PhD in Applied Mathematics from University of Arizona, and he has MS in Aeronautics and Astronautics from University of Washington, and has a bachelor's degree from University of Peradeniya, and basically from Sri Lanka. Welcome, sir.
Welcome. Thank you very much. Most thankful for reading through my boring career. It's in some sense it's evolved by various accidental turns and various opportunities come in my way, and so that's how my career looks like. I worked in the Navy, I worked for the Air Force, I worked for academia, and so forth. When I went from Sri Lanka, I was essentially a mechanical engineering BTech graduate. So I wanted to excel in high-speed aerodynamics and stay as a dynamicist. During my master's, then I realized that I'm interested in the deeper mathematical issues of aerodynamics. And that's how I got lost in mathematics. So, interdisciplinary is a very good topic. As you could see, even by my education, I was interdisciplinary because I couldn't focus on one area. And why not become a famous mechanical engineer, heat transfer, propulsion or whatever, and stay in that area? And I couldn't do it. And I often thought about that, why I couldn't stay in one field. But then to my dismay, this kind of having a multi-faceted portfolio became very fashionable. Right now, is multidisciplinary is the norm. So it looks like we are pushing students to become multidisciplinary. But for a while, I thought I am just drifting around. So anyway, so you can ask any question. I I didn't go to United States going to work for the Defense Department. I just want to just stay in some university and study, you know, teach aerodynamics and things like that. But somehow opportunities came in my way. And so I took some steps which I didn't dream before. And that's how I became sort of a very, you know, was able to hold some influential positions in the U.S. Defense Department. So I have some unique perspectives that way.
Yes.
So you can start with your first question.
Yes, sir. The focus of today's interview, specifically coming at a time when we have already interviewed a series of higher education leaders across the academic, and also today, especially because we have just heard and seen the conclusion of the conclave that has been conducted by UGC on transformational reforms in higher education under the New Education Policy 2020, where a multidisciplinary approach is now being given the more focus as well as the research aspect. And that was the topic that was chosen for today's interview for our stakeholders, which includes students, parents, institutional faculty members, as well as leaders, not only for our institution, that is Dayanand Sagar University, but across the academia. Now, yourself being in the multidisciplinary space, as you rightly identified, how do you see this policy panning out with the multidisciplinary focus and research approach for the entire state of stakeholders today, students, faculty members, institutions?
Yeah, it's a very good question, actually. So, a traditional approach for engineering education, for example, takes the view that we had to provide a solid foundation in some core courses. For example, if you are a mechanical engineer, there are some traditional courses in fluid mechanics, solid mechanics, and controls, and so forth. So the academic establishment takes the viewpoint that we need to cover, we need to educate students, let's say 70% of 80% of their undergraduate degree in those traditional areas. And the traditional areas haven't changed for decades, and for a good reason, because this is how science evolves, science matures. So, you will find that leads to a paradox, because when the student completes the degree, let's say in mechanical engineering or electrical engineering, aeronautical engineering, and the industries demand much more background, broader background than traditional engineer. So, you know, these days, if you want to get a job in Google or Microsoft, where the young graduates would like to go, they conduct their own exams, four or five interviews. Why don't they, like in older times, just, okay, you have a great degree, we have a 30 minutes interview and we'll take you. And those days are gone. So what does that say? What are the industries telling us? Industry is telling us that, okay, you teach whatever you want, but we are going to have our own way of evaluating, because these students may not be industry ready, or may not be have the computational algorithmic skills and in the some of the AI machine learning type high powered programming skills in Python and things like that. They may not have focus that much to the extent the industry needs. So, so then there is certainly a disconnect, right? So what the industry needs and what the traditional mindset in the university, the faculty have in preparing the students versus the student finding a placement. So that is one. So that's the immediate job. And but when you go into a industry or in the academia, unless you never get into an administration or leadership position, otherwise the other attributes come in: your communication skill, your how good you are in writing proposals and grants and things like that, your team player skills, your leadership skills. These are not taught in a traditional BTech program. Or maybe it's just an elective in your senior year. Or maybe, for the sake of covering the UGC requirement or AICT requirement, here is six soft courses. And that may not be enough, because the best of the students then think of these things as just some hurdles to clear. So so it doesn't then produce leaders. You know, you often hear about the brightest students going to the industry and then ending up in a corner, whereas another student who is didn't really finish at the top, but he had the people skills and other skills, so he ended up being the leader and essentially being the boss of this smarter student. So then does it mean that this means that what is the correct mix of engineering and social sciences for a degree? So when we went to US, and also I graduated from the most selective school in Sri Lanka, University of Peradeniya, or University of Sri Lanka Peradeniya Engineering Campus. Likewise, if IIT students go there, until recently and even now, a year ahead of the undergraduate, US undergraduates. Why? It's because our syllabus was 100% tech engineering, whereas in the US, they study a lot of soft classes, communications, sociology, and things like that for the first 2 years, and then eventually specialize into engineering. Of course, the regulatory body like ABET will make sure that you will study a certain core component of the engineering. But in the US, they prepare better as a more better rounded students. So maybe we will beat in the PG classes an American graduate, but in the long run, he or she is going to do better because they have the leadership skills and communication skills and writing skills, which something that is completely focused on tech did not provide, whereas we were very good problem solvers. Go ahead. So you want to go for the second question?
No,
go ahead.
Here I wanted our Dean Research, Dr. Banga sir, talking about some examples, sir, about the Infosys and the intake. Would you like to share this?
Sir, anyway, I think you are the, I can't get anybody better than you, because you are truly multidisciplinary, expert, I should say, from mechanical to mass. What a transformation, really great actually. That doesn't happen in most of the cases. We have seen there are silos. Each department is, entity in its own right. That's what has been the case till now. I think that will go with this, NAP 2020. That's what I believe in. Now, I think there is a dire need of for this multidisciplinary approach in our education system. Last year, I was seeing one news item wherein it is stated that Infosys has had hired 7,500 plus people in the US, and I was amazed to see that more than 30% of them were from social science background. That was really a news as such, because social science people will never get into computing or writing code. So, whereas in the US system, as you rightly said, they're preparing their students for the industry, for the real life, problem solving, environment, they will be the best fit. That's what I believe in.
Yeah.
By opening up this way in India, most of our people, even from social sciences, will also get opportunities in the industry, because they have got a domain knowledge of become students. Once they graduate with this multidisciplinary approach, they know the domain and they know the technology. So they will be the best to work in any fintech company. That's what I was trying to figure out as to how good the system is going to be. Okay. Similarly, there are many other cases. In Indian
politics.
Leaving out IAC and some top-notch institutes, I think now even they should study mathematics so that they can do the modeling in their own area and the better results. I think this has come better late they're never right. That's what I would say.
Yeah.
Though we are great, still we are into that. That's a great thing.
Yeah.
In NAP 2020. I think you can dwell upon this, you know, say how this is going to transform our education system.
Yeah.
Having this multidisciplinary approach, I think, you know, say it will be great if you...
So in the US, it's not uncommon for somebody who is doing mathematics to go and do economics for PG. And somebody who has done physics to come and do PhD in electrical engineering, even though you may be expected to go back and take some classes. But since the sciences is also a four-year degree, so that is one thing to pay attention, because in India, it's BTech is 4 years, but BSc is 3 years. The parents as well as the children think that there's a sharp divide between BSc, Bachelor's Honours, and BTech. For example, a parent came with his daughter who has taken first year in Canadian university and in computer science, but she wanted to transfer to our program. So we said, well, sorry, we don't have the computer science is full. So then I said, you know, we have a computer science degree offered by a mathematics department, which is focuses on AI and machine learning, and 80% of the classes are same. But even before I finished, the parents said, sir, no, sir, BTech. I am BTech, my son is a BTech, my dog is a BTech, so my daughter shall be a BTech. And so he thinks that, unless you do undergraduate this BTech degree, you will never become an engineer. But it is, if you go back and look at many of the famous inventors, and so they have all kind of multiple degrees. They may have a degree in chemistry, they have a degree in engineering, because that gives them broad perspective, right? Often you may be surprised that you have a certain perspective gained by studying, let's say, electrical engineering, and then you go to, let's say, Los Alamos lab, and then you meet a physicist who is also thinking about the same subjects, electromagnetics, just that with a different viewpoint. So then you learn. And this is how I learned, actually, when I first went to US Navy in 1990 for a summer faculty fellowship. So 3 months fellowship in San Diego, I went inside the Navy lab. And at that time, I was an aeronautical scientist. I was pretty good expert in fluid mechanics, control theory. So I thought that's pretty broad. And so I sat in a seminar inside the Navy, and it was on signal processing, signal detection. And most of the audience knew a lot of probability. And I didn't understand at that time, at least, what they were discussing. And I was very embarrassed. So then I decided to learn, stochastic process and probability, and that's how I became expert in that area. And otherwise, if had I not gone to Navy, I don't think I would have ever. I would have simply happy, I'm an aerodynamics, fluid mechanics, computational theory, that's good enough, right? But then some area hit me from, from the left. Then I learned thinking. And then many of the scientists you meet inside defense lab or US government's energy labs like Los Alamos, Lawrence, Livermore, it's all physicists. That's another shock you see that I thought aeronautics is everything. And then you go inside a lab with thousands of people, and mostly they are all physicists and applied physicists, and they talk another language. So you learn from them because it's... then I became a branch head in the Navy, and they would come, and somebody said I am very good in things, and so they came and asked me about all kind of radar detection of small targets and so forth. I never even thought about. So then I started reading about those things, and so you learn. So the career gives you opportunities. And so to become multidisciplinary, you had to be open-minded. And then if you are hit with an area you don't know, you don't become defensive and say that, okay, no, I don't want to go there. I want to stay this way. Be open-minded and you will find that your background, original background helps. Because you know, that is always with you. Just that you learn and use your subjects and now you know two subjects, right? So, so I think the curiosity, being open-minded, and willing to explore new areas and bit intellectually courageous and fearless, it helps. And cap them all, you need what's called intellectual humility. That means that I'm going to be surprised by areas I don't know. I will be meeting with people who would know about things incredibly deeply, about things which I haven't thought about. And I don't want to simply say that I don't want to know what you want to know, what you have, and I will just stay. But instead of that, show humility and talk to that person. So I would go in the Saturdays, and I had a physics friend who was very good in atmospheric optics. So we will just sit down and talk. And he will explain to me about, the various frequency ranges of LIDARs and radars. Then I was, get fascinated how much he knew about why, the clouds have different colors and whatnot. And why ocean only absorbs blue-green range lasers and, whatnot. So you learn. And so the meeting with people outside the area and interacting with them with humility always helps. So the fundamental change the universities here are going to undergo is going to be tough, I think, because the Indian system is still very rigid about the BTEC, right? AICT will say, okay, they teach these classes. And so we have now big debate in Ramaiah University, where we have, since we have introduced four new BTEC programs, all of them with artificial intelligence and machine learning flavor. So how that is going to displace or maybe give a new perspective on the traditional areas, from aerospace to mechanical engineering to computer science. These three of the degrees will stay inside computer science. And the robotics, which is also very much AI and machine learning, will stay inside mechanical engineering. So then there's a competition between the traditional mechanical engineering and the robotics courses. And traditional ME scientists, engineers say, well, let's teach the traditional mechanical engineering. And then we will sprinkle some robotics courses at the top. So then I said, a student comes in, and hoping to study robotics, and then they will say, after 2 years, these guys haven't taught me anything about robotics. But then, of course, AICT has this rigid rule that you had to teach the same classes for. So we go by that. But we had to start telling them about robotics because this student came to study robotics early on. And that is the competition, intense competition between the traditional mindset that we need to teach these things so that this is a legitimate mechanical engineering degree versus the paradigm change and the society's needs, where it says, you can't, if you teach all of that, we don't have time to study AI, machine learning, or computational science, right? So that's a healthy competition. Now, if you try to introduce social sciences classes, the best of the BTEC students would be probably may not like it, because this BTEC is, for example, very mathematically oriented subject, whereas the social sciences are descriptive. That's a different talent, right? So it will be interesting how engineering is going to incorporate these traditional classes and to what extent our own engineering professors and our profession is going to tolerate that. Anyway, so.
I was thinking that we do have in the policy framework that there will be multidisciplinary education and research universities, and focus on National Research Foundation in order to ensure and inculcate this focus, which you, having been in the international space for so long, you would have seen, but it's lesser practiced on a larger scale in India. How do you think that is, this policy framework will really help to inculcate that across the
country? Yeah, so it's, since I worked for Defense Department, I know about the funding dynamics quite well. In the US, you have for basic sciences, you have the National Science Foundation. And then for the health sciences, you have NIH, National Institute of Health. But then also, each of the defense department has his own NSF, so to speak, Office of Naval Research, Air Force Office of Scientific Research, and Army Research. And also, Energy Department has also basic. So there is multiple funding agencies which can fund university professors' research, so that a professor who wants to work on areas that is relevant to Defense Department can apply to one of the defense funding agency, or if he wants to work on really fundamental areas whose applications may not be immediate, or can apply to National Science Foundation. So the National Research Foundation in India was that idea is essentially imitating the National Science Foundation. And I know that the National Education Policy had Manjul Bhagava, who is a Fields Medalist in Princeton, and he's a pure mathematician, so I'm sure I think his funding was from NSF. So he was must have been an advocate in this creation of National Research Foundation. But I hope is that they don't take the viewpoint that they will only fund IITs and the cream of the cream, because as pointed out in one of the discussions, that private universities are also taxpayers, and private universities also have very good scientists, and the best of the universities in the of the world, in particular in the US, are all private universities. Right, all these universities you hear about, Stanford and MIT and Ivy League, Harvard, all of them are private universities. So why don't we think of a time, maybe 10 years from now, maybe 5 or 10 of the Indian private universities will attain world-class status. In order for that to happen, the National Research Foundation has to be willing to cultivate and support young talent within private universities, regardless of, in the US, it's the funding agencies don't really look at the ranking of the university to fund. in principle, any university, a good proposal comes along, and the faculty member has good publications to support, the funding agency will support. So they are not prejudiced to say that, okay, unless you are from the top 100 university, you don't even think of us. So that, I hope the National Research Foundation, when they form, they should take the viewpoint. And then NSF also has the what's called the EBSCO. So what they do is, and then Defense Department also has the similar program, where they looked at the landscape of funding and they realized that funding is from all agencies, Defense and National Foundation, concentrated on top universities in California and top universities in East Coast. They said, well, that is unfair. So they selected 14 states which are least funded by the Defense and the National Science Foundation, and allocated special funding and gave them. So when I was in University of Wyoming, we is one of the EBSCO state. So they get direct funding from the National Science Foundation and also from Department of Energy and Department of Defense, because this Wyoming is not as funded as California. California has density of a lot of. So the government is thinking about, it's not just we don't go after the top universities only, because we had to grow talents in every university. So I hope National Research Foundation has a flexible viewpoint so that they don't just go and give all their money to IIT, Madras, and Indian Institute of Science. They will hopefully fund Ramaya University and Dayanand Sagar and so forth, right? Because we also have good young faculty, we would like to see them succeed and grow as good scholars. And eventually, who knows, in 10 years from now, some private university like ours can beat IITs also, because we are working a lot harder than, I can see that. There is no other, I have never seen any other organization in the US, where they work as hard as here, I can tell.
Much harder we work.
Yeah.
That is quite encouraging, and I'm sure a voice like this, or a message like this, will go out to the policymakers to ensure, because we were also hearing something about the focus on the top 100 institutions, universities, and the question.
I do not really support that, because then what happens to the rest of the 900 universities India has, right? So does it mean that they are not supposed to be benefited by the taxpayers' funding, which all of them contribute? So I am a foreigner, so I don't want to get into this politics too much, but I wanted to say that they should take a broader viewpoint, and I think they will take a broader viewpoint. And the ranking they talk is because here then immediately the competition is going to be much higher than in the US. But of course, ISRO and DRDO also has funding possibilities. And these days, I know Indian private universities are actively seeking, and my university also has a number of faculty who are funded by both ISRO and DRDO, and also DST. So the funding culture is growing. That is, it's not one-to-one like in the US. In the US, if you're in an applied science area, engineering or applied physics or health sciences, if you are publishing and if you are not funded, then your paper should not be good. because the mindset is that if your research work is good, then somebody should be willing to pay for it, right? So, you can't really take that viewpoint yet, because we don't have enough funding opportunities here. But they had to be connected. So the culture of sponsored research has to be cultivated inside our departments and private universities too.
All right. On a contrary, quickly, because you have to also be proceeding to attend a meeting. Does this also open up opportunities for international collaborations? We can take the dialogue further later, but in brief.
Yeah. So I have, because of my defense department, I am connected with many, many, many universities in the US. So after coming here, we have signed MOUs and connected with several US universities, and we have been organizing webinars not only from US but also UK and Australia, and we can partner certainly, maybe jointly host some distinguished lectures and so forth from US. The time difference is an issue, but we can make that happen. Delighted to work with you guys.
Right. That's a very positive note, I think, on which we would like to also end and give you the opportunity to go ahead and proceed to meet you further on. Definitely looking forward to working with you, sir, jointly. Parting, I think, note will be given by Dean Research, Dr. Banga, sir.
Okay, thanks.
Well, sir, in fact, now we had a very enlightening discussion. Mm. And as I said, to talk about a multidisciplinary approach in our education system, I think you are the best person to talk about it. And I'm sure the way in which NEP has been drafted and laid out, I'm sure it is going to augur well for the country. That's what I believe.
Yes.
And even in the input, that's great. And though you are too busy, I understand that you have taken time to come and discuss with us. On behalf of our university, I thank you profusely for taking time off and be with us for about half an hour time. Thanks again, sir.
Thank you. When the things settle, I will come down and visit you guys.
Yes. Oh, sure, sir. Yes, I will come down there. In fact, I used to, when I was with the Wipro Technologies, I used to visit your center
RIT.
Near MSRIT,
I used to go there.
Afterwards, not much time, and I had once I joined here after moving out of industry. In fact, I know many people. In fact, your Kulkarni.
Raghavendra Kulkarni.
Yeah, in fact, I was with the Reva University for 1 year in the inception stage.
Yeah.
and he was with me. I hand over charge to him.
Yeah, he's an outstanding professor.
Yeah. Great, sir.
That's how it is,
sir. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Banga, sir. Thank you, Dean Research, Dr. Banga, our beloved Dean who's been inspiring.
Thank you, Dean Research.
Promotional programs in order to educate our stakeholders. Thank you so much, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, for gracing our research cell, Dayanand Sagar University. We will invite you in a further session. Signing off from research cell, Dayanand Sagar University. Have a good evening.
Okay, thank you very much.